good afternoon. Thank you for the introduction. A lot of different aspects have been brought up regarding the issue of hydropower, gas, and the renewable future of Europe. So what's basically left for me to say is what is currently happening in a 2020 perspective. So what is the most likely scenario, what we know today, and also to talk a little bit about 2030. So I will focus more on the close future and not the medium-term future. So coming back to this nice graph, so this 2050 perspective of the European Union, when we talk about power, the focus is not really on 2050, because basically most of the carbon reduction that we see in power is due to in 2030. So just to mention this, that we don't have to focus on 40 years, but on 20 years, and therefore it's much more important what will happen in the next 10 years, basically, because here most of the important decisions are made. And of course, also an important issue in this regard is the 2030 target, or the 2030 targets, which are in discussion by the European Union. And on the other side, if we look on the perspective from Norway, we have a similar perspective to 2050. So Norway is somewhat more ambitious than the European Union, talking about carbon neutral system. The difference is basically the starting point today and the 2020 perspective. So we have heard many times that Norway basically has 100% of renewable supply and electricity. Still, in accordance with the 2020 plans by the European Union, it has agreed to rise the share by a couple of percentage points to 76.5, so that's, today it's roughly 60%. And therefore we have the two perspectives. On the one side, the Norwegian perspective, increasing the renewables, and interestingly, one important aspect thereby is even further increasing renewable output in electricity. So we see 100% today, and in 2020 we might see 110–115%, and then most of it is supposed to be exported to continental Europe. The European Union and the European Commission has a slightly different interest in this North Sea region. Of course, renewable imports are always a good thing, but for the states surrounding the North Sea, basically United Kingdom, Germany, Netherlands, and Denmark, we foresee an enormous increase in wind power in the next 10 and 20 years. And therefore, the idea that's coming more from continental Europe, and that has been brought up by the speaker before, is to have this really strong integration of hydropower from the north, Norway, Sweden, but also in the Alps, and connected to the North Sea with lots of wind potential and the demand center in Central Europe. So basically, from a more technical point, what's happened, we use more resources, and they should be exported into the North Sea. And on the other side, we have the four countries south of the North Sea, which have to meet their 2020 targets. And this is mainly done by wind power. So when we had a lot of discussions about CCS, I haven't seen any statistics that CCS will have a major impact on these 2020 targets in Europe. So if we just talk about what we know today and talk about the technologies that are available in this region and that are applied in a large scale already today, we would have to admit that wind power is basically the technology that will provide most of those achievements in the renewable share for the electricity sector. So to reach the 20% renewable in energy, that means about 35% of renewable electricity in 2020. And if we increase this level to maybe 40% or 35%, we end up roughly about 60%. And that's in 2030, not in 2050. And therefore, basically, there has to be some balancing, some backup capacity. And instead of building something new, it's obviously always a sounder way to integrate to something that exists. So if we link those two perspectives, we see that basically both objectives, the increased renewable from Norway, but also the demand for more balancing and resource capacity from the continental European continent, asks for more transmission infrastructure in this region. So what happened in the last years in this region? You see this system today, so we have already heard that there's a connector between Norway and the Netherlands since a couple of years, between Norway and Denmark. And there are plans for a couple of new interconnections, which will increase the exchange capacity to 4,400 megawatts, so 4.4 gigawatts in total. And basically, numbers have decreased in the last years. So a couple of years ago, there was a discussion of having two interconnectors instead of one to Germany. Then there was a discussion of a second interconnector to the Netherlands. And there was also the idea first to have about 1,400 megawatts for each connector to Germany and to Great Britain. But in the last years, these volumes have been further cut down step by step. So talking about the lead time and the investment time of those infrastructure projects, it's very likely that that is the situation we will see basically in 2030 or at least in the mid-20s in the offshore grid or the offshore links in the North Sea. So is it sufficient to address both issues, both perspectives? So the perspective of exporting electricity from Norway and the perspective of balancing wind power in the North Sea region. Well, for the export, we have two constraints. We have the capacity, which could go in both directions, roughly 4.4 gigawatts. And if we do some calculation on the volumes Norway is on an annual basis supposed to export in 2020, to increase its renewable share, that would mean that on average half of the capacity has to be exported and is therefore already blocked. Of course, you can export less in some hours, but then you have to export it in other hours. So there's not really a situation that you could use this kind of infrastructure for this large-scale application of hydro pump storage as suggested just a couple of minutes ago. One example, if you import with half capacity over 2 hours, you would have to export at full capacity for 4 hours to get the balance right. And for the capacity of wind power in the North Sea, it's the numbers I found, basically the national plans from the UK, from Germany, Netherlands, and Denmark, they add up to 100 to 110 gigawatts in 2020, and about 150 gigawatts probably then if you continue this path. So we have the same numbers that we saw in previous presentations for 2030 or even later already in 2020. And therefore, if we want to have a sound integration of the Norwegian hydro system into this development, there's also a different development in timing. So because of the 2020 targets and the reduction targets thereafter till 2030, the investments in renewables are really processing at a very fast speed, especially in Germany, but also UK and other countries are expected to invest more in wind power in the next years. And at the same time, because of different reasons, there's a cutback in investment plans to connect Norway to continental Europe. So maybe to conclude with this last slide and discussing some of the aspects, what are the benefits of Norway to actually not integrate that much? And what would be the possibilities to have a better integration of the two systems? Well, first of all, we said that this level of investment in infrastructure is sufficient for the integration of the renewables. So from the national objective, Norway is actually doing fine with this kind of infrastructure. And as well, if you would have to integrate the systems even closer, you run into social acceptance problems. And for my kind of observation, I have a better impact view now on Germany. We don't have this nationalization of electricity markets only on policy, but we also have it on infrastructure. So what we see in Germany right now, also because of the uncertainty if some integration cross-border into other countries will come up, we have a very strong national focus in realizing the 2020 and 2030 targets, which include a lot of wind power, but instead of having stronger connections to Norway or also to Sweden, etc., the plans include a lot of onshore transmission to connect it to southern Germany, so to say to resolve the issue on a national level. And basically that's not the cheapest way, and that's probably not the soundest way if we talk about a perspective where we want to see some European electricity market develop over many decades. So there's some development which probably doesn't go into the right direction. One positive thing about these plans we see today, however, is that we have to ask ourselves, what does the public think about those investments? So this planning only came up, or this plan only came up in Germany's entire process in the last 2-3 years, and therefore the first time there was a really public discussion on this issue. What does it actually mean in terms of infrastructure to have this kind of energy transformation? And in this kind of process, the German network operators, the regulators, the public, everyone has learned a lot out of this discussions on what do we need, why do we need it, what are the implications on the system, what alternatives are there. So there's a lot of knowledge that was in, like, was an output of this discussion, which, if we think about the development of schemes like the North Sea Grid or connections between Norway and Germany, could be also used in this discussion. And I understand that there's a similar discussion in terms of infrastructure in Norway. And maybe with this better understanding of the challenges we are up to, it might even be possible to talk about schemes where, in a regional sense, so a regional system, you can get infrastructure investments done, which are not really necessary for the national renewable targets. So for Norway, it's not necessary to build those power lines, additional power lines to connect pump storage plants in southern Norway onshore. It's more a service where there might be some business opportunities, but of course you have to kind of translate this to in the public consultation. And one comment on the business case on transmission investments. For me, transmission is a regulated business. So basically, it's not a decision based on the business case, but you generate or you create new business opportunities by getting more integration of different systems. So it's not an investment decision that has to collect arbitrary rents between systems. If you optimize your congestion rents between systems by transmission investments, you never end up with sufficient transmission capacity. So you should rather sit together and have some regional planning on a combined approach for system planning in the North Sea. And by that, you will create a lot of interesting business cases, and hopefully we will see some development like this. So thank you from my side, and I'm happy to discuss and ask questions and enjoy it to be here in this marvelous round, and hope that you will have a great time being researchers or, well, thank you.